How do you feel about leftovers? I've been accused by my wife of not eating them. I'll eat them if they're really good. But, you know, the nature of leftovers is the stuff that you didn't really want the first time. But I collected our leftovers. And I don't know what this will say about us, but it'll get your attention. So we have some chicken I grilled, or I roasted the other day. Didn't bring the maple orange marmalade glaze, but it's good stuff. This looks disgusting, but it's mulligatawny soup. It's so awesome. Got this recipe from the soup cook-off we had. I got some leftover sweet potatoes. You can eat a vegetable, that's a good choice. Oh, this surprise. Brian Fairbanks made the best macaroni and cheese I've ever had in my life at our men's thing the other night. He put bacon in it. Oh, it's so good, I can't wait. And I got half a mango left and some poppy seed rolls. So, you know, if you're gonna eat leftovers, pretty good options. Although I wouldn't think of inviting any of you over to my house and serving you leftovers. But it may be better than what you're eating anyway. But still, it just would not seem right. I wonder how Jesus feels about leftovers. Let's look at a familiar story in John chapter 6. Verse 1, the feeding of the 5,000. John 6, beginning with verse 1. Encourage you to open up your Bible if you have it, or your app, if that's all you're using your smartphone for. And would you stand for the reading of the word? John chapter 6, beginning with verse 1. After this, talking about Jesus' teaching that happened just prior, Jesus crossed over to the far side of the Sea of Galilee, also known as the Sea of Tiberias. A huge crowd kept following him wherever he went because they saw his miraculous signs as he healed the sick. Then Jesus climbed a hill and sat down with his disciples around him. It was nearly time for the Jewish Passover celebration. Jesus soon saw a huge crowd of people coming to look for him. Turning to Philip, he asked, "Where can we buy bread to feed all these people?" He was testing Philip, for he already knew what he was going to do. John just always seems to give away the ending. Have you ever noticed that in his gospel? Anyway, Philip replied, "Even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough money to feed them." Then Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "There's a young boy here with 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what good is that with this huge crowd?" "Tell everyone to sit down," Jesus said. So they all sat down on the grassy slopes. The men alone numbered about 5,000. Then Jesus took the loaves, gave thanks to God, and distributed them to the people. Afterward, he did the same with the fish, and they all ate as much as they wanted. And after everyone was full, Jesus told his disciples, "Now gather the leftovers so that nothing is wasted." So they picked up the pieces and filled 12 baskets with scraps left by the people who had eaten from the 5 barley loaves. When the people saw him do this miraculous sign, they exclaimed, "Surely he is the prophet we have been expecting." When Jesus saw that they were ready to force him to be their king, he slipped away into the hills by himself. The word of the Lord. Let's pray. God, I pray that this familiar story will inspire us afresh today. It's your word, but I pray that you'd help me to communicate it and help everyone to receive it and change us, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. The feeding of the 5,000. Pretty famous, iconic story. Did you know that this story occurs 4 times in the Bible and in all 4 of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John? Well, that doesn't sound all like that big a deal, but it's the only narrative outside Holy Week that occurs in all four Gospels. Holy Week, Jesus' triumphal entry, the cross, the empty tomb, all that stuff, obviously, occurs in all four of the accounts of Jesus' life called the Gospels. But there are no other stories that are captured by all four writers, all four evangelists. Well, so what? Well, I think that's significant. I tell people, when they're trying to understand Scripture, that, if it just occurs once, you can't ignore it, but maybe it's not as weighty as if it occurs, like, if you find something in the Old Testament and the New, and then if it's in the Gospels and, and the writings of Paul. If it's in there lots of times, it's like neon sign from God. Pay attention. Now, we can't dismiss anything in this book, but just adds to the weight of it. All four of these writers, gospel writers, felt like this was an important story. This was worth including in their account of Jesus' life. The Holy Spirit, who inspired them, who was with them as they kind of sorted through the notes and their thoughts and, trying to figure out what to put down on paper, said, this is important. Preach this narrative at least every other year because it is that important. And my take, as you'll recall, is this. I say, all right, Jesus did the miracle. Ooh, I have some bread here. What a coincidence. He got the loaf, and it was just a little loaf and little sardine-sized fish, and prayed God's blessing, and then he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples. That's what we read in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. You remember this sermon? Preached it to you a dozen times. And then they, started breaking this blessed, miraculous bread, and it kept multiplying somehow to feed approximately 20,000 people. If Jesus himself had just tried to break off, that much bread, I did the math once. 100 pieces a minute to feed 20,000 people. It would have taken like 12 hours. So my take, I think it's good, is that Jesus couldn't have done this miracle, couldn't have met the need without the participation of his disciples. Okay, he's Jesus. He could have done it. But, this was the way he chose to do it, and they had to participate. Is it ringing a bell to anyone? And they learned the power of partnership, cooperating with Jesus, being his hands. Important lesson that I'm sure would come back to them many times throughout their lives. And, it's worth paying attention to for us when we are working with Jesus, when we're partnering with God, some pretty cool things can happen. Our little becomes much, it goes further. We can accomplish more than we can imagine when we are in partnership with the divine. So that was a sermon in like 2 minutes. But in John's version of this story, the disciples really don't play a prominent role, okay? Just reality. He's emphasizing different things. In John's gospel, the miracles of Jesus are signs that testify to who he really is. He is the Messiah, the Christ, the anointed one of God. Whenever we find a miracle in John's gospel, it screams out, "This is no ordinary man. He's the Son of God." That's John's agenda to help us see, help the readers see who Jesus is. And the people got it, more or less. They received this message in miracle form. We read at the end of the story, they realize this is a great prophet. This is the one we've been expecting. And they were ready to, you know, escort him to the throne room. And that wasn't what Jesus had in mind, so he slips away. But they got the sign, the miracle, that this was no ordinary man. Jesus kind of gets on their case. We'll talk about that next week. Been covering, you know, a chapter a week, a story a week. We're going to linger in John 6, so buckle your seatbelts next week. Hard teaching, deadhead. But today, in John's gospel, it's about the boy. The only time he's mentioned. Did you know that? You read the other three accounts of the feeding of the 5,000. We don't learn about this little boy, this lad. But John thought his story was worth telling. He's young, very young in the language of the New Living, which, you know, probably means he was well under 12, the age when you became a man, bar mitzvah. You know, he wasn't there yet. I'd like to think he had to be at least a preteen to be wandering around the countryside without his parents. I mean, maybe his parents were around, but you kind of sense he's alone. And that's kind of cool. I think we underestimate our children sometimes. Becky drug her children to prayer meeting last night. That was awesome. And the new and Schwanda grandchildren, they were there for at least a while. And, you know, an hour of prayer is a long time for children. It's a long time for you guys, too. But that was just so exciting to see, you know, them engaged in, you know, at least seeing what it's about. Anyway, he's young. He's also poor because barley was the bread of the poor. Just screams that, you know, he comes from a non-affluent family. It was a third the price of wheat. No coincidence that detail's included. We would understand he just didn't have much. And he's self-centered, right? Like all children are. I wasn't generous when I was a kid. I didn't share. I'm still not great at it, but he just gets it for some reason. He's willing to give of the little he had, and it was a little lunch, little loaves of bread. We think of a loaf, but it was just a morsel of bread and teeny sardines. But here's the question I've been grappling with. Why did he give it all? I mean, Jesus could have done this miracle with probably one loaf and one fish. You know, and that still would have been impressive, this preteen boy willingly offering part of his lunch to Jesus. But he gave it all. Why did he do that? Because the need was great. 20,000, give or take, hungry people. I can't remember if I'm supposed to mention this here or not. There were other people with lunches that day. There had to be, right? Disciples are walking around looking for something, and everyone's like, I don't have lunch, you know. But this boy, you see him say, hey, I'm willing to share. I have something to offer. You know, he realized that there are going to be a lot of hungry people that day. And in the other Gospels, we kind of learned that they'd been there a long time and they were really hungry. The need was great. Jesus asks. Doesn't directly ask him, but his disciples probably were saying, you know, the teacher is looking for some help. He's asking you to give what you can. You know, the request initiated with Jesus to find food. I talked to my baptism candidates. When Jesus asks, and now's not the time to debate or negotiate or look for loopholes. If we belong to him, our default is, yes, whatever you want from me, it's available for your purposes. So those are pretty good reasons. The need was great, and Jesus, and he didn't probably yet know who Jesus was, Lord and Savior, but we do. But I have to believe this boy also knew somehow that his need would be taken care of. Probably should have used the word met. He knows that his need will be met. He will be taken care of. He had just enough food to get him through the day. He was probably hungry and needed something, but he trusted Jesus to take care of him. He knew the scriptures. The psalmist declares, I have never seen the godly abandoned or their children begging for bread. Somehow God provides for those who put him first. He might have even thought of this great passage from the prophet Malachi. Bring the tithe into the storehouse so that there may be enough food in my temple. Then if you do, if you put me first, says Lord of heaven's armies, I will open the windows of heaven for you. I will pour out a blessing so great you won't have room enough to take it in. Try me. Put me to the test. He probably grew up hearing these scriptures, being assured that you can't outgive God. So he gave. Maybe he had heard Jesus recently. Maybe Jesus said this more than once. Give and you will receive. Your gift will return to you in full, pressed down, shaken together to make room for more, running over and poured into your lap. The amount you give will determine the amount you get back. Words of Jesus himself. And he probably had read the stories of the widow at Zarephath. Mentioned her not too long ago. When God asked her through the prophet Elijah to sacrifice what little food she and her son had left to live on. Little wheat and little oil to make a meal for the prophet. It's all she had. But the prophet said, Just trust God. And she did that, and her wheat and oil never ran out. I was thinking about, actually I was racking my brain to think of other stories, because that's a great example. And the Lord reminded me of a couple other things. This morning, these were late additions. You know the story of Hannah, found in 1 Samuel. She's barren, can't have children, desperately wanted a child, and she made a promise to God. If he would give her a child, he would give the child back to the Lord, which I know we've all wanted to do at some point, but this was quite a sacrifice. And God blessed her with the son, Samuel, and she kept her promise. And he went to live and work in the temple. Her only son offered back to God. Well, God blessed her for her obedience, for her sacrifice with 5 more children, we read in 1 Samuel chapter 2. Abraham, similar story. bizarre story when God asked him to literally sacrifice his only son on the altar. The son of the covenant, the son that was going to be the beginning of this great nation. And Abraham offered his son back to God. God stopped him before the knife fell. Solomon, David, others gave what they had to offer to God, and he returned so much more. We can't outgive God. I don't think we really believe that. We like to have contingency plans and leftovers and reserve accounts, and we often miss out on the blessings God has for us. But I'm no prosperity gospel preacher. I don't believe that, you know, if you pay your tithe, you're going to be driving a new car in 6 months. Or maybe ever. You know, sometimes obeying God and honoring Him with our time and talents and treasure is a real sacrifice. But He does always bless. His promises are true, that if we live in obedience, if we are faithful with returning back to Him, time, talents, treasure, then He'll bless us. Sometimes He just fills us up. We read about that a couple weeks ago when Jesus went hungry for the day, but full of joy and God's presence because he'd been faithful in ministering to the woman at the well. I shared, we talked about this in our men's group last Friday night, that, you know, they're all stuff we'd like to do, great day of skiing, great round of golf, things we enjoy tinkering with, you know. But the best days, my best days, are the days when I've worked with God, worked with the Holy Spirit, when He's used me to show someone His love and help them have a better day. You know, when I've been a blessing to someone else, that's a really good day. You know, I reflect on my day and really the quality of it has to do with how obedient I was to Jesus. And I think the group kind of agreed that those are the best days when we've said yes to Jesus, when we've taken risks for Him, gone out of our comfort zone for Him. Just something happens on the inside. It's better than a belly full of food. He fills us up. And, or, He teaches us to be content. Do you ever kind of calculate, we shouldn't do this, how much you'd have in the bank, or, you know, how much more secure you'd be if you never, you know, gave money to the church, if you hadn't been a tither? I don't. Hadn't had a new car, really, since 1988. And I didn't care. Okay, I got a little old breaking down the side of the road. But just God has given us the ability to be okay with a little rust and, you know, some engine noises. And we finally did open a door for us to get a new car after all these years. But we didn't need it. You know, the contentment of, like, it's okay if I don't have the latest and greatest, the nicest and newest. If I can't go, you know, to exotic locations and fine dine, I eat pretty good. contentment. It's ironic that the harder you try to get what you want, the more you want, and the less content you become. But when you get first things first, Jesus says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. But you don't want as much stuff, right? When he's first, when your security and identity is in Jesus, then the things of this world just don't matter as much. They matter. I enjoy taking trips, but I can live without them too. And then we got this going for us. It means a lot more to me the older I get. The best is yet to come. The reward, you know, the payoff is in the future. Now, Jesus says, if we sacrifice here now, there are blessings in this lifetime, and there are. Can I get an amen? I mean, I'm blown away on a monthly basis, if not weekly, about how good God is. But the best is yet to come. And, you know, Jesus teaches in a parable of the talents that the reward kind of depends on how faithful we are, how obedient, how generous, how sacrificial. Can't earn our salvation, but there are rewards. Heard someone preach on that a few months ago. The promised rewards in the next life. And if the God who created the universe is making the reward, it's going to be good. It's going to be good. We live for the greater reward, not for the here and now. That's the default of the Christian. You know, not so heavenly minded, we're no earthly good. We're not talking about that, but we don't store up treasure on earth because it doesn't last. We store up treasure in heaven where moth and rust don't destroy and thieves don't break in and steal. God sees every act of service, every dollar given with a humble and grateful heart. He keeps track of it. He will never forget. So what was the payoff? I didn't even put this in your notes. Can't believe it. His needs were met. I mean, he gave his lunch away, and he probably got three lunches back. You know, I mean, everyone ate all they wanted. That was kind of a given. I think Jesus was just so pleased with this boy, patted him on the head. Paul writes that when we give, the aroma reaches God, it blesses God, it brings a smile to his face when we are obedient, when we are faithful, when we're generous. It had to feel good, you know? As 20,000 people were, you know, leaning back with full bellies and letting out their belches, saying, to think I had something to do with that. I was a part of that. Best day ever. And a partner with Jesus for a miracle, to be a participant in the supernatural activity of God. That's something you don't forget. I mean, this had to be a highlight of his life. He told his grandchildren, I want to tell you about that day when I gave my little lunch to a guy named Jesus, and he met so many needs. Anyone want to be famous? To be remembered? 2 billion people have read his story, give or take. I don't think it mattered to him, but it does to some people. I mean, I'm not saying you'll have fame by being obedient, but again, God never forgets. And it was pretty cool. Little boy comes to church with a lunch and ends up becoming remembered, recorded in the greatest book ever written. But what about the leftovers? 12 baskets full of leftovers. What happened to the leftovers? 12 disciples, 12 baskets. I think it was just convenient because each of them had a basket, you know. So they got to pick up all the leftovers. But what'd they do? Jesus goes off and hides, but what did they do with the baskets? Well, he had to get at least one, right? He leaves home with a little lunch. Can you see him walking in the door of his house? Hey, Ma, you don't believe what happened today. You don't have to cook for the next month. I don't know if barley bread lasts that long, but it'd make a great story. He gave all he had, and Jesus gave far more back than, you know, than he could have imagined. That's what he does. Not always materially, not always in the here and now, but we can't outgive God. And I'm not just talking about money today. I'm talking about what we do with our time and talents. He's calling some of us to get involved. And you may think, man, that's a sacrifice. But God's thinking, oh, if you'll only obey, if you'll only trust me, you have no idea what I have in store for you. What is Jesus asking you to do or to give or both? There are needs that won't be met unless you're obedient. It's just the way it works. And if you'll obey, if you'll be faithful, I don't really like the word happy. It's kind of an emotion, here today, gone tomorrow, but there's just contentment and joy, and it sure blesses God. He sees every gift we give, every moment given to him. He remembers. He pours out blessing greater than we would ever expect. So what is Jesus asking you to do? So Jesus, I have a feeling you have been. And maybe we haven't been listening well, or maybe we've been making excuses or doing the math. That always gets us in trouble when we do the math. Because your math is different than ours. You are trustworthy. You own the cattle on 1,000 hills. And I believe you want to release blessing on our people, but our lack of obedience, our disobedience is hindering that, Lord. We wonder why we struggle. So ironic. We can't make ends meet because we're not putting you first. So help us, God, to do what you're asking us to do. Give us faith, and that's how you strengthen faith. You do things when we're in over our heads, whether you're calling some to get involved in our children's department or teen department, just to help out in different ways, Lord. Help them to say yes, and maybe this is about giving, tithing, the first tenth, coming back to you. That's always been the standard, the minimum we're to do, but man, just waiting to keep your promise. So help us to obey and to be blessed, we pray. Amen.
The day the Lord changed my life relative to what Pastor was talking about, the winter of 2000, my wife and I just bought a mobile home, and we weren't quite married yet, so it would have been 2002, and at 2 o'clock in the morning, there's a knock at the door, And I'm thinking, maybe it's my wife. Maybe there's some sort of emergency. So I get up out of a daze. I open the door, and standing there is a young black man. And I was nervous. So I crack the door, and he's got a bag in his hand, and he's bleeding from his head. He's got a cut on his head, and he's bleeding down. And I'm like, what do you need? And he's like, I need some help. And so reluctantly, I let him in, and I hear the story that he's talking about. And his uncle, I was in a trailer up the way, he was staying with him. He had been abandoned by his mother and father. He was staying with an uncle and had hit him in the head with a bottle, a glass bottle, and was busted. And he had all his belongings. He had packed up into this garbage bag, and he's standing on my front door, and the Lord says, here's an opportunity for you. And we spent some time talking a little bit, getting to know each other and the situation that he was in. And so I let him stay, to kind of shorten the story a little bit, let him stay overnight. So I pinned a chair up against my bedroom. So I'm like, please don't kill me. I'm trusting, you know, I feel led to let you sleep in my house. And then the next day, again, so he's got a cut on his head, and he's got everything he owns is in a sack and a garbage bag. And so the Lord says, you need to give him a coat. He doesn't have a coat to wear. And so I go to my closet, and I go to this really old coat that I had, and he's like, nope, not that one. The next one over, you know, your nice coat that you wear. Okay, all right. And so I reluctantly pulled it out, and I said, here, you need a coat, man. It's cold outside. And do you have all your belongings in a garbage bag? Yeah. Well, I think I can help you out. And I went to get, you know, this old duffel bag that I had from high school. And he's like, nope, my uncle had just bought me this nice $75 Nike bag that I really enjoyed. And he said, nope, I need that one. And so, okay, God, what do you have for me? And I took that out and I gave it to him. And I said, here, you need to have this. And the Lord is telling me to give this to you. And where do you need to go? We piled in my car. He needed a ride over to another relative's house to stay. And I don't know what happened to that kid. It's been now 20 almost 15 years, I guess. And I never knew or found out what happened to him. But the Lord changed my life that day, because it was about saying yes, right? Those opportunities, when they come, what are you going to say? And I will follow you. And we're going to close the service. Would you stand with us? We're going to close with that song to encourage us. But when those opportunities come your way, yes, Lord, I will do what you ask.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow. Thank you. and I will follow. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. Where you move, I'll move. I will follow.
Share the love of Jesus to those around you. And we'll see you next week.
Stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.